warm welcome to our moderator, Simon Spanswick.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this session on a very small topic, the future of international broadcasting. As you heard, my name is Simon Spanswick. I'm chief executive of the Association for International Broadcasting, which is the trade body for cross-border broadcasters all over the world. And I was delighted when Deutsche Welle asked me to chair this afternoon's session with some luminaries who I'm going to introduce in a few moments. And I hope over the course of the next just under 90 minutes, we'll have a great discussion. We'll find out what the panel thinks about the future. And we'd also like to make this as interactive as we can to find out what you think. It's your session, not ours, so please make sure you're ready to contribute. But before I introduce my guests, let's take a look at just how much the world of international broadcasting has changed.
Говорит Лондон. В эфире русская служба BBC.
Papież Paweł VI przyjął na audiencji prymasa Polski kardynała Wyszyńskiego.
And that's the news on VO8. I'm Kay Gallant in Washington. Willis Conover is next.
The news from Radio Deutsche Welle, read by Dick Norton. Western governments, joined by NATO and United Nations officials, have voiced relief at the re-election of Russian President Boris Yeltsin.
You're listening to Radio Peking. We'll first bring you the news, followed by a Peking People's Daily editorial entitled Combating Selfishness and Criticizing and Repudiating Revisionism is the Fundamental Principle of the Great Proletarian Cultural Revolution.
How things have changed in my lifetime, and in the lifetimes of some of these people up here as well. So let me introduce the panel on my right. We met him this morning, Peter Limbourg, Director General of Deutsche Welle. Then we have Cécile Mégie, who's Director of Radio France International. Alongside her is John Lansing, who's Chief Executive of the Broadcasting Board of Governors. And on my far right is Jean-Philippe de Tender, who is Director of Media at the European Broadcasting Union. Now, what I'd like to do to start this afternoon's session is just ask each of you, because there are some people in the room who may not be entirely familiar with your organizations, just to give a 90-second intro and say what you think this session needs to discuss. So, Peter, let's start with you.
Well, thank you, first of all, and thank you for your nice video. You should do something with media, I presume. It's really nice. It was really illuminating, the change. First of all, Deutsche Welle is the German international broadcaster. It's state-financed, but it's independent. We have independent boards and controlling us, and we are not the voice of the government. We are the voice of the whole Germany. So also the opposition has its place, and all the variety of people. This discussion, I think, is here to give us all maybe some ideas where the future will go because of the digitalization and social media. I think the audiences are more fragmented, and so we have to find intelligent ways to reach everybody, and also to see where we stand towards other institutions coming from other backgrounds and trying to bring in their way of life, and some call it propaganda, but I think this is everything we are now faced to, the international crises and the total change of distribution and digitalization.
Okay, over to Paris, Cécile.
Over to Paris, but I will said the same thing than in Bonn or Berlin. So I'm I'm the French director of Radio France International, which is part of the group France Média Monde. You've seen pictures of France 24. And we also have an Arabic-speaking radio, Monte Carlo Dualia. RFI is speaking in 13 languages, French and 13 languages. I think what we have to deal with nowadays as a publicly funded state broadcaster, like other members here on the panel, is that we've never been in conflict being on the one hand, a vector of public diplomacy, maybe, let's say soft power sometimes, and on the other hand, a reliable and trusted content provider. And that is the core of our business, let's say. I think the quality of contents remain the core of what we have to do, regardless of the platform we use to transmit and to go to the listeners or readers or whatever.
Okay.
And we have to deal also, obviously, with all those. Really, we've seen it in the little film you broadcast just now. It's the huge globalization and the huge and very fast changing of the world all around.
Mm-hmm. Okay. From Paris to Washington, John Lansing. You haven't been long in the job as CEO of the BBG. Yeah, tell us about it.
About 10 months. It's going well. First of all, thank you, Peter, for the invitation. I think the day got off to a great start this morning. It really did. Thrilled to be here. So I'm the director and CEO of the Broadcasting Board of Governors. That's the five federally funded media entities of the United States government. So Voice of America, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, Radio Free Asia, the Middle East Broadcasting Networks, and the Office of Cuba Broadcasting. The two things that I sort of come into this panel thinking a lot about, first of all, three things, is to learn some best practices from fellow international broadcasters. To think about, as the video set up, to think about how we reach the next generation of audiences on those platforms that they're using, and understanding that those platforms are a different user experience than what perhaps many of us a generation behind are used to, because it's no longer a single tower blasting to a million ears. It's getting involved in conversations that often are peer-to-peer, and perhaps our role is to facilitate conversations as much as throwing information at people. And then what we talk a lot about at the BBG is looking beyond reach to impact. Of course, you can't have impact without reach, and reach is critical. But how can we measure the impact we're having and hold ourselves accountable for the work that we're doing? And we're spending a lot of time over the last 3 or 4 months developing an impact model that we can use with all five of our entities to be able to compare them to one another in terms of the impact they're having around the world.
Great, okay. Jean-Philippe, like me, ex-broadcaster, now involved in an organization, still with broadcasting, but slightly to one side, not a practitioner anymore. Tell us about your role at the EBU and the EBU's view on international broadcasting.
Okay, the EBU is the European Broadcasting Union. It's an alliance of more than 70 members who come from roughly 50 countries in Europe, but also in the wider Europe. And they are united around the same values in public service media. This is what really unites us. I agree with my colleagues on the topics. I would like to add two dimensions. What is really on my mind is that we have seen a shift from local to global. Media in the past were locally owned, locally produced. It was local creativity. It was a local ecosystem. But now we see global players mainly coming from Silicon Valley who really redefine what we are doing and who are the gatekeepers in between the audience and the content. Because that's the second topic. We're in the business of publishing content. You know, it's not about radio, it's not about television, it's not about digital, it's about getting the message out to the audience. But that is a difficult task today, because in between the content and the audience, there are many gatekeepers who have a separate agenda than the agenda that we in general have.
Okay, thank you for that. And indeed, as we saw, and you alluded to, John, the days of sticking a stick on a hill and getting people to tune in have long since gone, although that still applies in some parts of the world. But it's interesting, Jean-Philippe, that you mention Silicon Valley. There's a phrase that I only learned fairly recently called the gaffers, which is Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, abbreviated to GAFA. They've now become international broadcasters, and at the same time you've got players like Netflix saying they're an international broadcaster working in 160-odd countries. You've got Vice News, who are competing for the youth audience. Clearly, at the moment, the gaffers, with the exception of Amazon, are not content producers, and they're certainly not in news. So what does this mean for international broadcasting? Are we able to engage as an international broadcaster with these new players and have sensible conversations about distributing content and content partnerships? Or are they saying, we're not interested, you're hard news, nobody wants hard news anymore? Peter, what do you think?
Oh, I think it is it's a big opportunity also to talk to these content distributors or platforms, because if we just would say no, it's not our business, I think it would be wrong, because for instance, Facebook gives us a chance to get directly to our users and to get people interacting about the news we spread. And I think these companies, they also need content, and they are not originally content producers, mm-hmm. and but they have a different model. I mean, they try to earn money. We shouldn't make them as we shouldn't say Google is an enemy, but we should also not underestimate the power of this company and that they have their own interests. And so it will also be to find a fair balance that each one of us has the chance to be there on these platforms, and that it shouldn't be a question of how much is being paid or whatever to get on these platforms. It should be a free for everybody, and then the customer of these platforms should use and could choose what he wants to see, what he wants to read.
Do you think that they share the same values? I mean, John, you've moved from the commercial sector into international public broadcasting, so you've seen a dramatic change in working environment and mission statements. Yes, you've been out slightly longer there, so you know it's 2 years, so he's only had 10 months difference. So, do you think that the gaffers and other organisations of their ilk share the same values? Do they want to engage with organizations with the public service values that you represent?
I think they do. I like the term gaffers. I hadn't heard that before, but here's two things. One thing that hasn't changed and probably won't change, and one thing that has fundamentally changed, right? The thing that hasn't changed is any successful media enterprise has to be where the audience is at that moment in time in that era to attract an audience. So in the 50s, that was a black and white TV in the living room, or a radio in the living room, and then it was cable TV, and then it was satellite. So that's still true today. The difference is where people are today is holding an Apple, surfing on Facebook, and shopping on Amazon, and searching on Google. It just happens to be where the audience is. So nothing's really changed, it's just where the audience is. But here's what's changed. What's changed is the power has shifted from the producer and the distributor to the audience. So the audience chooses what they watch, they choose when they watch it, and they choose what to do with it once they get it. And the decisions about what people watch are generally more often than not now influenced by a peer-to-peer relationship, not a media company to a large mass audience relationship. So it's just interesting for me to think about what's not changed and what has fundamentally changed. It helps us at the BBG think about how to strategize for the future.
Mm-hmm. Gone are the days of listening to Willis Conover, sadly. I have to say I grew up listening to Willis Conover on Noisy Old Shortwave from The Voice and Music USA, which was a totally different type of music. So I recommend bring back some Willis Conover onto Facebook or something. Cécile, is it the same in the Francophone world? Because that's your main language.
Yeah.
And the gaffers are all English-speaking organizations from the English-speaking world. Does that make it a challenge?
Yeah, they are English-speaking, but I think it's really the same phenomenon in French-speaking world. And I agree totally on what you said just before. We have to be where the listeners are. And for example, in French, Radio France International and France 24, the French channel of France 24, are the main, they have the most huge fan club on Facebook, for example, for the French media, French-speaking media. We are the first on Facebook because we understand that dealing with the best content, if we don't know, if we don't go where the listeners or the readers are, and young listeners and readers, we won't deal with it. So we have to be there. And another example is that France 24 has made a partnership with Mashable in French. Mashable came to France and asked France 24 in French because they knew it, they knew the channel, in English-speaking channel in the United States, and they made a partnership with France 24 in French to have content, France 24 content. And what I think is that our content, the mark we have, the label we have for RFI, which is a very old radio, or France 24, which is maybe a youngest TV channel, is what we can offer to the listeners and to the readers, and they recognize this mark wherever we are, on Facebook, on Twitter, on whatever social media we broadcast. So that's the main thing.
This morning, Petey, we heard a lot about the work of co-productions and partnerships. Is this now absolutely crucial to your mission, working with partners and also looking at new ways of producing programs, not just from within Deutsche Welle, but from outside as well, with collaborative partnerships?
Yes, it is crucial, because I think the times where we just spread our information around the world and hope that somebody's listening to us is over. I mean, we have really strong partners, and I'm very happy that we have, for instance, Channels TV. John Momo is sitting there, and his wife, which are really helping us to get our content into such an important country like Nigeria. And on the other hand, we get a lot of insights from our colleagues at Channels TV about Nigeria. I mean, if we sit in Bonn or in Berlin or in Washington or Paris, and we think that this is, we know how the world functions, then we will do some really wrong stuff. And so I think these co-production idea is something where everybody has a benefit. So we, Channels TV gets interesting content, and we get interesting insights and professional reports from out the country. So it's a good mixture of international and regional content, moderated by a Nigerian colleague from Channels TV, and we get reach, because without reach you wouldn't get relevance. It's an old story. You can be absolutely relevant if nobody listens or sees you, then you're only relevant for yourself. So we need this help from regional partners to get reach and relevance. And I think it's a win-win situation, where we see that also, I think Channels has a benefit that its brand is going to be spread all over the world via our DW News. So we're going to broadcast, or we're already doing this since April. We broadcast it in Nigeria and around the world, the same product, and it's Echo at Africa, so it's an environmental magazine, and we're quite proud of it, John and I think so.
I'm going to put John on the spot in a little while, so stand by your bed. Co-productions are one way of doing things. You've also got a network of partner stations, all three of you. Is there still an appetite from broadcasters, large and small, apart from Channels, as we've heard, to work with big broadcasters? And what benefits do you think they accrue? Not necessarily what you accrue, but what do they accrue, John?
Well, I think it's mutually beneficial. And in fact, it's the very definition of pluralism, right? So if you were, sometimes people raise the question, are we in the business of propaganda? And the answer is absolutely not. Because if we were, we'd by nature, we'd have to have one message that goes to an audience and is unfiltered and unaltered and unchanged. The relationship with our distribution network allows us to push our content out and for them to share their content back that we can then again share back out into the system. So it's a completely pluralistic relationship that allows, it's the manifestation of what it means to have a free and open press in supporting divergent views from all over the world, in different varieties and different perspectives. And I think that's the win in all of it. is just that.
And RFE is working on the ground in certain challenging parts of the world to help broadcasters set up. Shall we have a look at a quick film from Radio France to set the scene? So if we can play the next video, please.
Radio Njoku a tout récemment vu le jour cette année dans la localité centrafricaine de Bayanga, à quelques pas du parc national Tsangasanga. Installée au mois de mars dernier, la radio communautaire est aujourd'hui opérationnelle et diffuse déjà plusieurs heures par jour. Entre reportages, actualités locales, musique, la population de Bayanga bénéficie désormais d'un espace d'échange et de témoignage. En langue traditionnelle Baaka, Njoku, cela signifie « éléphant ». Et Radio Njoku, c'est le cri de l'éléphant dans la forêt. L'équipe de Radio Njoku est aujourd'hui au complet. Journalistes, animateurs, techniciens et administrateurs ont été recrutés. Depuis la création de la radio, deux sessions de formation ont été organisées. Et pour cela, des experts locaux et internationaux se sont rendus sur place. Comment enregistrer et monter une émission, animer et passer à l'antenne, comment utiliser le matériel radiophonique et surtout comment gérer une radio communautaire, l'apprentissage de Radio Njoku se fait pas à pas. Radio Njoku est une radio communautaire. Elle porte la voix de la communauté de Bayanga. Tous les jours, des messages sont diffusés à l'attention de tous les auditeurs afin de les inviter à participer à la vie de la radio. Ces messages sont diffusés en 6 langues, en français, sango, baaka et bien d'autres encore.
Que la population soit informée à tout moment de ce qui se passe en République centrafricaine et également dans le monde.
So the Central African Republic, one of the most challenging places in Africa to work, it's been described as one of the nastiest places to go and visit. Give us a bit of more context around the establishment of that station and why Radio France International got involved.
It's one of several examples of this kind of radio, which the aim is to empower developing communities and share what we defend as a radio program. What we share as our values, our debate, contradiction. We can put on the same radio program two people who doesn't share the same point of view, and we have to learn to teach to those communities how to do a radio like this instead of fighting in the street, for example. So we deal with this kind of cooperation for years in Radio France International, even several English, French-speaking countries in Africa, of course, sometimes or in South America. And this is really a program which we are quite proud of it, and which can empower the developing of the communities all around the country, not only in this city. If they know what happens in this little town, we can do other programs all around. And we have also big experiences in Republic Democratic of Congo, which is in the east of the country, with always very difficult condition of broadcasting and very difficult condition of dealing with those people. But when we go to this program, when the programs come on air, it's a very little team that deal with this. It's really a big victory because you've done something for the community.
And does Radio Njoku broadcast RFI news, for example, as well, or not?
Not especially. Sometimes they do. We have a large panel of partnership radio all around the world, about 1,000 radio, which are broadcasting our program. But this one can do her own program, and that is the aim of this program. They do radio by themselves. We teach, we learn, we have a learning journalist who is a teacher journalist who is coming there, and technicians and all this kind of people. But it's in the community program, not only RFI. Of course, they know RFI, they already hear about RFI in the country. We are broadcasting in French in CAR, but they broadcast their own program.
And how do you measure the impact? Because the problem is that these places are vast. These countries have huge geographic territories. Presumably Radio Njuko is only broadcasting to one town with a population of, do you know how big it is?
I won't be sure of the number of the figures that of this population, but it's very a small area.
Yeah. But so how do you measure the impact of that type of work? And how do you then decide where next to go? How do you prioritize where needs help?
It's pretty difficult. The impact, how to measure the impact, is that we have other candidates to, and the other people ask us to come and to develop this kind of community radio. But the situation are very different and sometimes very dangerous either. I mean, in CAR, it was not so simple to work for a few months. So now we go back and we improve this method. But what I'll say is that we really know, with a lot of correspondents, and because we are there for a long time, we very well know where it can be useful to go, and with contacts on the field, they ask us to come, and we have a journalist correspondent, but also technician correspondent, and they tells us where to go and where it be possible and useful.
And do you get material fed back? Because we heard about the two-way street from John. Does that happen? Does RFI use material coming in from the stations
radio,
you've set up?
Not directly on our programs, but those people can also be afterwards some of our correspondents, and we can have information through contact like those. And it's very useful. It's also a win-win partnership anyway. It has to be so, and we have to be there. We are on the field, we are known, and that can be a way to have other partnership with maybe bigger radio, or to settle in the country sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Jean-Philippe, do you see this as part of the public purpose of publicly funded broadcasters?
Sure, I think that measuring impact is crucial today. When you're a commercial company, you measure impact by, you put in 1 euro. If you get more than 1 euro out of it, then you have a profit. In the case of public service media, in the past, it was about having a reach, reading a broader audience with news and content that could be trusted, which is still the case today. But there's a new dimension coming in, is how do you measure the impact? It's not about return on investment. It's about return to society. How do you contribute to society? How in bringing good news? How in bringing programs about book, how does that have an impact on people reading books? So one of the main programs of the EBU now is to try and really measure what this impact is all about, which is for sure a very difficult exercise to do. But I think it's one that is core to public service media, and I would say to media in general. I always say media is power, but I dislike that word, because when you say power, it could be propaganda. So media, in the case of all the partners here, is about how do you have an impact, how do you contribute to society, how do you contribute to democracy. And we need to find better ways to measure this, because this as well will be when we go to governments to get funding to prove what the role of media is today.
Okay. You reminded me earlier that you came not so recently from commercial broadcasting. Do you share that notion of return on investment being returned to the public? And how difficult was that to sort of get your mind around when you moved?
Well, not so difficult, because I always worked in news and information, so this means that you're always on a line between making money or losing money in a private sector. So
does any private news channel make money?
Yes, when they spread a lot of documentaries, then they will do money. But it's kind of difficult here in Germany because you have such a strong public media.
Yeah.
So, nowadays I think we can measure impact. Yes, by doing research, how our audience sees the world. So I think this is maybe might be the same thing at the Voice of America or RFI. So our audience has a higher positive or has a more positive view on democracy and tolerance, for instance, than the average population in the world. So I think this already shows that with the international broadcaster who is based on democratic and values and exchange of opinions and cooperation, this has an impact. But on the other hand, if you don't have the numbers, so if you just have maybe 2 million users a week worldwide, then you will not have impact. Mm-hmm. You can be as great and full of good ideas and good wishes, it won't work. So you have to have the figures to see, okay, how do we reach these figures? Are we showing international cat videos, or are we showing real serious stories with the social and political relevance? And then you have to balance this. I mean, you have to see what kind of content are you spreading? And it should be the content we all think of, but it should be also a bit sometimes entertaining, because always trying to show people how sad and difficult the world is also not the answer. So I think we have to have a good mixture, but we're not showing international cat videos with this, for sure.
None at all?
No, not at all.
Not even German cat videos?
No, not even, no.
It's very sad. I don't
but
know
we report on how many people show cat videos. No, seriously.
That's good. interestingly, I mean, when you look at the audience figures for the three broadcasters we've got around the table, they're in the hundreds of millions. And before you took on the role at Deutsche Welle, Peter, did you really understand as a commercial broadcaster here in Germany just how big the reach of Deutsche Welle is? Because international broadcasting has always been sort of ghettoized. In the past, it's been pushed into a corner, whether it's the BBC and the domestic services looking down on the world service in the old days and so forth.
It changes now.
Yes, absolutely. Because, I mean, currently your audience is probably around just under 120 million, give or take. That's quite big, and it's bigger than any German broadcaster.
Yes, I have to admit, I was really surprised in coming in here, how many people we reach. And you need a couple of years, probably, to overview the impact you have and the possibilities. And so I think it's a phenomena which we all know, that international broadcasting is not as reputated in your own country, but luckily this changes slowly in Germany, and we see all these crises around the world. We see international terrorism, we see globalization, we see the problems in the Middle East, the refugee crisis. And the refugee crisis showed everyone in Germany, every politician, every media man, that globalization is not somewhere far in the distant. It's just here. It happens here. And I think this helped us also to get more awareness for international media, and at the end to get a bit more money out of our sources. Yes.
So numbers equal money.
Yes, but without money you can't do anything. Mm. So you need a quite good financial basis, and we reached this, and because we all know that it's not only creating nice programs, it's also distribution, it's satellite, it's new partners, whatever. You have to invest, and we are in a situation now where we have to serve every distribution channel. I mean, even if I say, great, I love social media, it's wonderful, and I see that maybe it is not as expensive as it has been in the past to produce a video, but still I have linear television, we have satellites all over the world, we have radio, even still there is shortwave radio, which is quite expensive. So, and I won't switch off just one way of reaching our people. So it's getting more costly, and maybe in 10 years, when linear television might be not gone, but not as important, we will maybe see in another future. But now, linear television is still strong. It is worldwide. I mean, they're growing markets. It's in Africa. It's growing. It's in Asia. It's a big deal. It's more the pay TV market, but still we have to be in there. We have to be on every platform, mm-hmm. and this is expensive.
Cécile, France Media Monde, 82.9 million, give or take, quite a good figure. Do your domestic colleagues understand what you do?
Not all the time. I share exactly the same position. I think we're, for example, just for RFI, we are broadcast in France only in Paris, in Paris area. We have no FM around the country. And we are known, well known, and now with websites and apps, we can be heard, of course, in Marseille, in Lyon, or wherever. But we have only one proposed FM in Paris. And this is a lack of, knowledge. I mean, the French listeners pay for us. And the taxes, the French taxes are part of our budget, most of the part of our budget, and they can't listen. So we do have a big strategy developing our broadcasting means in France. In France to be known, and that when we need money, we can ask, listen, you know what we are broadcasting, because not only for the listeners, especially for the politics, because they don't even listen what we do in Africa or wherever in the world. So yes, RFI is a big, huge radio and historical patrimony radio, but what else? We need means, we need money. I think we all need more money to develop, to address all the challenge we have to address. So this is the very important thing.
Because it's money, yes, but it's also regulation. Yeah. When we see that France 24 has a great Arabic service, and they are not supposed to broadcast in their own country, yeah. but they have a high amount of Arabic-speaking population, which there is a lot of problems with integration. We don't have to stress this, but it is like this. So it is a bit of a stupidity not to broadcast the own great channel, and it's the same thing. Which helped us here in Germany was the refugee crisis, because we took every effort together with private sector, like Astra, SAS helped us to bring on our Arabic DW channel into Europe. And so you can now see the Arabic program here in Europe, and we enriched it with programs of the colleagues of RRD and ZDF. And so we now have an offer. But still, we are also lobbying towards politics that we should be no problem at all in every possible way, whether it's cable or whether it's internet, to see our foreign language programs. Because, as you said, taxpayers paid for it. And it's not these territorial principles. They're long, long away. I mean, we have globalization, we have digitalization, people are traveling. We have in Germany more than 100 million visitors every year. Why should they stop their app when they cross the border? This is kind of old thinking. So I think we also have to be visible here in the country so that the people who pays us, that they see the benefit of it. Mm-hmm. And this will also help us to get better programs abroad.
John, you've got the same problem that there is a law, or has been a law, up until fairly recently, or is it still in place, that you cannot broadcast The Voice, for example, within the US?
Well, it was modified, that law was modified to allow it because it was available online anyway, so it had to be allowed because audiences in the United States can get it online, and people can request content from us as well. It's just not... it's not something that I see changing for us, but I think the point that Peter makes is well taken. We definitely need the money and the investment. I think the key to driving that investment for us is how we tell our story to the funders, to the Capitol Hill, the appropriators, to the White House, And the key to that is that we can explain to them that we're doing something unique with our work, that we're not out there just being another CNN, for example, doing the same news, different brand. And so we've been thinking a lot about the kind of approach we're taking in different parts of the world, like, for instance, in the Middle East, MBN, Al Hura, and Radio Sawa have a program called Raise Your Voice. And Raise Your Voice is a unique set of content that covers three platforms in a progression for an audience. So it starts off as a TV documentary that takes cameras into the homes of families in Iraq who've had ISIS recruitment, who've drawn a son out of that home, and you see the impact on that home when they find out that son has been martyred, for example. And that moves to a radio call-in show that puts a question on the call-in show that people can call in and comment on that. And then that moves to a managed Facebook chat page that we have 200,000-300,000 Muslims, moderate Muslims, engaging with each other around this question of the day that derived from the TV documentary and from the radio call-in show. And so we've kind of stepped back from blasting information and news, and we've become creating the apparatus for an audience to talk to one another peer-to-peer around a subject that we think is important that can help move the impact needle forward in Iraq. So that when we can take that to Congress or to the White House and say this is what we're going to do with the money, then we tend to have a greater success than just saying we just need more money, dot, dot, dot. Mm-hmm. So it really is tying the money to something that shows that we have an interest in having impact when we spend that money.
And what about the potential for collaborative investigative journalism, for example? I mean, we've seen recently the Panama Papers with the New York Times and other media organizations working together on that. Is that something that you'd like to see your organizations doing, working more closely with others that aren't directly competing with you, but are nonetheless adding to the horsepower to be able to do big stories like that?
Yes, and I've always been a big believer in investigative reporting as having the greatest, most measurable kind of impact if it's done well and done right. And one example of that is Radio Free Asia, who took on a story of water pollution in Laos that local media wouldn't touch because they were afraid of government concerns over reporting on that kind of corruption. But after Radio Free Asia reported on the story, it sort of gave local media some cover to go ahead and cover it themselves. So it wasn't a direct collaboration, it was more of an impact that freed the local media into getting involved with a story that otherwise, had Radio Free Asia not done it, they wouldn't have likely have done the story.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you agree with that? There needs to be collaborative journalism outside to broaden the impact of international broadcasters?
Oh yes, of course. And I think everybody of us has had examples. We had also collaboration between journalists in Nigeria together with our office down there in Lagos, and we have opened an office in Lagos and 2 years ago, and they did an investigative story about human trafficking of women being trafficked to Europe, to Italy, and together we made it. So again, it was a good result of our cooperation with Channels TV. We wouldn't have made it alone because we're not so close to the population. So I think we need collaboration, and also the example John just said is important, that we open gates for others to say, well, now we can go into the story because it's open already. So I think this, but on the other hand, it's an ideal thing to say we can do so much investigative journalism. Investigative journalism is very expensive. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to tell people, okay, you have 3 weeks of researching, and we're fighting here for every half have headcount and saying no, you have to work longer or whatever, and then you have to say no, go out for 3 weeks. So it's for us it's luxury, one has to say. We sometimes can provide it, but it's not the daily business we can provide.
Jean-Philippe, do you think that there's more room for collaboration between the domestic broadcasters that are in the majority in the EBU and international broadcasters to try and share the workload?
Definitely. I think we discussed co-production before, but for me it's about exchange. There's good content available elsewhere, and if you can exchange this content, it will also broaden our view on the world. because I think that diversity is one of the crucial values we have within the EBU. It's not about a top-down approach and say, so we think this is how the world looks like and we report about Africa or Asia or the United States. It's about having local people reporting in their network, in their local networks, and bringing this news to other people. And I agree with Peter that investigative journalism is expensive, but it's, I would say, crucial today because news is moving to very fast news. We're used that when news happens that within 15 minutes, you know, with the Brussels attacks, you have a camera standing there and you watch all of this, you know, live on television. The day afterwards, it's Orlando. The day afterwards, it's the US elections. So it goes very fast, but we do need to provide much more context to news today. And I think that somehow that's one of my mantra is that news needs to slow down again. We need the fast. For sure, when it's breaking news, we expect everybody to be there with a camera, with reporting, with instant analysis almost. But what happens afterwards? If you look at the migration crisis, we got pictures daily about migrants trying to get into Europe. But we had great coverage about all of this. But now what happened, you know, a year after this, months after this, who is reporting about a migration crisis? The topic is still there, but it's no longer in the news, and it should be in the news. And I know that we're all under pressure because of funding, but finding the right balance in this breaking news and providing context is crucial. And there I think that if we share the same values, have the same views on what the role of news is, there we can collaborate much more together. You know, we should forget that we are competitors on the local market, on the European market, on the global market, but try to find ways to connect with the audience, with the content that really can make a difference.
We heard this morning a lot about Turkey. Turkey is an accession state to join the European Union at some point in the future. You've given an award this morning to a journalist who's been under immense pressure. At the same time, we see TRT, which is the national broadcaster in Turkey, about to launch on the global stage TRT World, an English language news channel 24 hours a day, coming out of Istanbul. It's recruited a huge number of people from Al Jazeera and Sky in the UK, and France 24, I think, have sent some people over there, or have been lured from France 24, is what I meant to say there. What do you see as the impact that that could have, given the challenges there are with press freedom? Do you think this is a good thing to have another channel, another international news channel, and coming from Turkey at a time of press repression?
Well, I hope that the colleagues there will do a good job, but I have a bit of my doubts because when we announced that we gave the award to Sedat Ergin, I read the TRT news, and it was like we had given out a German-Turkish friendship prize to the editor-in-chief of Hürriyet. And half of the quotes were gone, vanished. So it is kind of a, let's say, one-sided reality, which is maybe produced there. But it's always difficult to judge about something which is just in construction. And so I hope the best. And on the other hand, it's good if you have a lot of voices, because that's plurality. And I think. It is fine that not only BBC, CNN, Deutsche Welle, and our French colleagues are saying how the world should be or reporting how it is. So it's fine that there are others. But every user should know that there are different ideas behind it. We have the idea of tolerance and plurality. Others have the ideas of promoting their foreign ministry's views of the world. So. Everyone has to judge.
You mentioned the challenges of getting funding for your organization. I haven't yet managed to find out, although I've done a lot of digging, what the TRT world budget is, but I think it's quite big. And when you look at Turkish Airlines now flying to more places than anywhere else, I'm not sure they make money on this, it seems that there could be an awful lot of money thrown at this.
Probably yes. I don't know. We'll see.
Could you collaborate with them on journalism projects? Or would that be a step too far?
I think we would talk with them, obviously, but collaboration means that there should be really a certain limited space where we can think of this. But first, I think we should see what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And if they only do propaganda, then probably they're not the right ones for us. But I want to be unfair. I mean, they're just
there. It'll be appearing on a screen near you fairly soon, I can tell you that.
Okay. Jean-Philippe, tell me how you like it.
Jean-Philippe, TRT is an EBU member. What does the EBU think about all this?
Well, TRT is a member. Turkey is not a member. And what you see in general, you know, across Europe and across the world is that you have various tendencies in public service media. You have the neoliberalists who say, well, we do need public service media, but we're not going to fund it. And then you now see governments who say, well, we need a public broadcast, we're going to fund it, but we're trying to bias the message that is going to be sent out. And I think that it's the role of the EBU to keep the members on board and from the inside, you know, try to convince governments what the importance is of independent news, why it's important to have a public broadcaster and not a state broadcaster. And for sure, that's not only difficult, but the easy way would be say, well, there's a new government. This new government is tending to state broadcasting, so let's get rid of the member. I don't think that is, in the long run, a solution. As media, we have a role to play. So I think this is very important in staying, in talking with these governments. We had the same in Romania, you know, having a big budget deficit with the Romanian television broadcasters, which is somehow damaging the union because the deficit of that one member could impact the rest of the members. But then it's important to go and talk to the Romanian government, why it's important to have a duly funded public service media broadcaster.
After all, they could win Eurovision if they came back in.
Yeah, they could.
We heard this morning about the growing sense of common European foreign policy, and I'm going to open this discussion up into the arena in a moment, but a final sort of question to put people on the spot and create a bit of angst, perhaps. With this common European foreign policy, and Europe becoming ever more federally close, depending on what happens on the 23rd of June in Britain. I still haven't made up my mind. I'm ready to be persuaded either way.
What do you mean you still haven't made up your mind?
Well, I'm waiting for you to ply me with lots of beer on the boat tonight and make sure I vote the way that you want me to vote.
This is how it works. Yeah, fine.
There's a growing sense of this common European foreign policy. So does that not inevitably lead to the idea that there should be a single voice from Europe rather than disparate voices from Germany, from France, from anywhere else? Should we not just have one European broadcaster, international broadcaster?
In an ideal world, probably yes. But the problem is that you would then have 28 or 27 editors-in-chief. Mm-hmm. And we all know how difficult it is to manage one editor-in-chief. So imagine that there were 28. So I think this is not a realistic scenario. And there are, I think, different views how we watch the world. I mean, the Americans have a different view, the French, the British, we Germans. So I think it would be better if we start collaborating closely and maybe find really islands where it makes sense and say, why do we do the same thing all over again? Why do we just make maybe some parts of it together? But in general, I think it is good to have the transatlantic voice, to have a continental European voice, or to have a voice from England, or Great Britain. So hopefully European United Great Britain.
Oh, we're getting a new job, a new title, right, okay. Cécile, do you agree
if it
with
helps.
Yeah, once again, I agree with that.
I can't get any division on this panel. This is ridiculous. They're all agreeing with one another. We've got to put some.
I think it can't be realistic. I mean,
no.
We're together, but we're different. And speaking from Paris is not the same thing than speaking from Berlin or from Bonn or from Washington, wherever. So I think what we support is the diversity, the plurality. So even in Europe, even if we have a Europe foreign policy, unique foreign policy. What a dream. I think it won't be a good idea to have only one single European media. I don't think it's realistic at all.
Mm-hmm. Jean-Philippe?
I fully agree, because the strength of the EBU is not that it's one voice, it's a plurality of voices who share the same values. Mm-hmm. However, what we try to do is that on certain topics you can work together and you can push governments or politicians, you know, to come up and speak about how they think. We try to have a common debate on the migration topic, with the Brits involved, the Germans involved, all of the parties involved, because this would have made sense. In the end, it was Merkel and Hollande who said, well, no, this doesn't fit our agenda, so we're not going to do this. But this is what we could try to do more often, and use the power of the audience, of the collective audience we have, to ask politicians not to talk on the topic only at a day, but put things in that perspective, which I was explaining about, and being responsible to the audience, because in the end, that's what democracy is all about. You're elected by the audience, and then you need to feedback to the audience what you think about. And there we have more power. Always when I'm in Brussels, we have 20 correspondents in Brussels, and they always complain and say, we try to get an interview with Juncker, but he always says no, because it goes to Bloomberg or to the Financial Times, the papers they read or the magazines they watch. But I said, all of you together, you have a potential reach of 1 billion. You should say to Juncker, you know, you have no other choice than to do this interview towards the alliance and do it collectively. Mm-hmm.
Do you think that'll work?
Sorry?
Do you think that will work?
Well,
do you think
we can try. That's what I'm trying to do, at least.
Okay.
I can ask the question. You know. They can say no.
Well, good luck. Let's open this up to the floor. I'm going to find a microphone in a minute. I'm going to come and pick on some people. But first of all, I'd like to do a show of hands. How many people in this room work for an international broadcaster, as a matter of interest? What's that, about a third? Something like a third, right. Good, that's interesting. How many people work for a national broadcaster? A smaller number. Okay, how many people in print, press, newspapers? A even smaller number, right? How many people tuned into an international TV or radio station today in the last 15 hours? A few. Oh, well, that's good, right. Do we have any microphones? And, oh, there's there. Right, I'm gonna pick up on one or two of those things in a minute, but I think, first of all, I gave him good notice. He's been thinking about this. John Momo, chief executive of Channels Television in Lagos, Abuja, and developing fast. How has the partnership with Deutsche Welle gone? You don't have to be friendly with him, even though you've got direct line. I can stand in front of you so you don't have to look into his eyes. But I want to know how it's worked practically and what it's meant for you.
I think it's been a wonderful experience. I think it's allowed us to scope and scale our production values, our production methods. And we've been able to piggyback on them to see how we can, foray into the international arena. And Echo Africa, which is running at the moment, is an environment, and it's a delight to watch. It's a very good one. It's rich content, and it touches the very core of the environmental problems that we're facing at this moment in every part of the world, and Africa inclusive. And we also, on a daily basis, work with Deutsche Welle on the floor of the Frankfurt Stock Exchange, and that's a winner, you know. So on a scale of 1 to 10, the experience has been 11.
Right, you've got a Marshall amplifier, okay. You also, hang on a minute, you don't get away that easily. You also work with the Voice of America. Which just predates by a few months the Deutsche Welle arrangement. But tell us about that. You're obviously sort of putting your eggs in
question,
one basket.
Well, it's a good thing you're asking me, because I have a very special relationship with both Peter and John, and John being my namesake. So we equally have a very interesting and wonderful experience with Voice of America. At the moment, we have we're able to work with the correspondents of Voice of America anywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. And we're rolling out in the northern part of Nigeria, and that would mean us working very closely with Voice of America to make that that come about. So,
what language is that going to be in?
It's going to be Dwal in the first instance, English and Hausa, and then later on we'll ramp things up. Mm-hmm. But it's a great experience. So international collaboration, international co-production seem to be the thing of the future. It's happening to us now.
And if you had a word of advice for another broadcaster that has been approached or maybe wants to approach an international broadcaster, what would you say to them?
I would say jump at it, work with them, and it's a win-win situation, just like Peter said. You take from them, you give them, and mix them together, and you know, and you got a good program, you got a good product, and you got a good reach.
Okay. Cécile, the days of international broadcasters talking to broadcasters in other parts of the world and simply saying, you will take that bulletin at 5 o'clock, have they all gone?
Sorry, I didn't understand.
In the old days, yeah. International broadcasters said it was almost a take it or leave it thing of talking to local broadcasters in other parts of the world, saying, you are going to take that bulletin at 5 o'clock in the evening for half an hour, won't you? Has that gone? Is it much more collaborative?
Yes, I think it's much more collaborative, and we have to be. It's exactly what we said before at the beginning of this panel. I mean, we have to address the audiences, and we have to be. They have to be engaged in our. It's a dialogue. Mm-hmm. It's a dialogue on the air. When we broadcast now, we have more and more program with dialogue with the listeners, and it's a. Permanent dialogue on new platform, digital platform, because when you post something on Facebook, you immediately have the reaction, you have to moderate them most of the time. So we have to be in this dialogue all the time, and on France 24 and on RFI, we developed a program which called The Observers, and this is a digital storytelling program. And the observers are our watchers, our listeners, and they bring us some facts with videos or just testimony, and we checked it. Of course, we have a very strong method to check them, and then we use it as our program. We did it in France 24 did it in French, English, and Arabic, and we adapt this program in Persian for RFI for the RFI. Persian program, which is broadcast on the website, and we do, as you do, a third program, which is TV, video, and video, social media, and then a radio program, observing the observers and taking the lessons to what is going on in Iran, in Afghanistan, and wherever. And it's a citizen journalism, which is called citizen journalism. I think we have to improve this method and this permanent dialogue with listeners and digital social media users, and so for all the media, not only national media, they did it too, but for we have a huge panel of contribution that can come to our channels, our programs.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? We have people here who are reaching 500 million people on this planet every week. You must have some questions that how they do it, what they want, what the future is. Anybody? Otherwise, I'm going to come and pounce on somebody.
There's one over here.
Right, I'm on my way, as fast as a speeding microphone can go at this time on a Monday afternoon. My personal trainer will be proud. Tell us who you are and where you're from, please.
Madi Sharma, European Economic and Social Committee in Brussels, but I'm also a freelance journalist for some Indian newspapers. Mm-hmm. I was on the BBC yesterday, on the local BBC, for the Brexit debate. Sorry to bring this one up. But the issue seems to be that Europe has failed the citizens because it hasn't communicated. By the same token, if I go to India, India's not aware of what Europe is. So how do we bring this citizen journalism, which I really like, how do we bring it so that we can get the message of what these great big organisations are in the world and what they're actually doing for the citizens? Because it's the time of social media, the time of communication, and yet we can't get a single message out that, you know, Europe has given us peace and security, Europe has given us good consumer rights. The average general public in the UK don't even understand this.
Do you think that's because the debate's been hijacked by political divisions within a certain political party?
For sure. For sure, on both sides. I think the Leave campaign and the Remain campaign have been absolutely terrible. And that was my point yesterday. Mm-hmm. I was speaking on behalf of citizens and what Europe has done for citizens. But the tweets that came back to me yesterday was, thank goodness somebody's starting to speak in real language. So I think it's back to this, how do we engage the citizens much more in media?
Let's ask somebody who lives in Brussels, Jean-Philippe.
I think it's a very important question. I had a meeting recently with collaborators of Juncker's cabinet, and we were exactly discussing this topic. Their idea is that if they have a message, you have to publish it. And the problem is that there's no way to digest their message in a way that it translates well to media. And I think there's a great work to be done by their Sherpas to think in a different way how to engage with the audience. One of the things I learned myself as being in media is that the job actually starts when you just publish the content. Because when you have published the content, then you have to listen to the audience. You have to engage in a dialogue, in a conversation, take part in social media in this conversation. One of the biggest lessons I learned was in 2006. I was about to recruit a consultant to advise me on social media. And the best advice he gave me was, you know, don't recruit me as a consultant. Just go on social media and take part in the conversation, which I did. And then the audience was, well, they said, well, no, that director TV of VRT, he's actually talking to me. And this is something that politicians don't do. They live in their ivory tower. And I think that from the citizen journalism part, there's a way to push these politicians and other official institutions as well to reflect on the way how they communicate, to reflect on the way how they engage with media in general, and how there can be a closer connection to the audience. I fully agree. Mm-hmm.
Following on from that, I suppose, John, you are in the throes of a certain political debate in the USA. I'm not quite sure how to phrase this question. What's going to happen, first of all? How are you going to cover that? How are you going to distance yourself as a US international broadcaster or five international broadcasters from the polemic and the distrust and everything else that surrounds the debate at the moment that we're seeing over here?
You're talking about the presidential election?
Yeah. Is there another one?
We got an hour and 15 minutes in. I thought I'd made a clean getaway. And so let's see. How would I answer that? I think that the media in general dropped the ball in covering the early primary season in both cases. I thought Bernie Sanders was regrettably underestimated, and I thought Donald Trump was more than regrettably underestimated. I also think there wasn't a really good job of fact-checking that was going on, particularly during the debates. And I surely hope that in terms of our own brands and our work, that we hold people accountable to facts. Facts are stubborn things. I was reminded last night at dinner about the great quote from Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan that said, Americans have a right to their own opinion, but not a right to their own facts. And there's still such a thing as an empirical truth. And when somebody, a candidate, utters something that's empirically untrue, that skates right by a questioner during a debate or a press conference or whatever that is, I think that's just sloppy, bad journalism. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of that has happened around all of media. So it's still a ways to go. This in some ways represents the best of what America is, believe it or not, because you're free to say what you have to say and do what you want to do, and people are free to form an opinion and cast a vote. So Donald Trump has collected 13 million votes so far in the primary season. It's now ended, and he's the presumptive nominee. I think Hillary Clinton has a few more million votes that she's collected, but I'd remind everybody that the winner of the last presidential election in 2012, President Obama, had 66 million votes to win the election, and he won by a fair amount, but even Romney had 60 million votes. And so winning an American election is different than winning a primary. And winning a plurality of a minority is different than winning a majority of a majority. So there's a long way to go here.
Peter, you're smiling wryly there. You've covered elections as editor-in-chief on a couple of occasions. What do you make of it all, and what's Deutsche Welle doing about covering this circus?
Well, first of all, I think it is a great story. I mean, we never thought that this election campaign would be such an interesting one. We thought there would be Bush against Clinton, and this is the return of this or another one of this. No, it's a new story, and it's very interesting, and it's very challenging, and sometimes you get a bit of afraid of how this thing can develop, because we're not talking about the mayor of Wuppertal, we're talking about the most powerful man or woman in the world. So it interests, I think, everybody in the world. So I think we don't, as Deutsche Welle, have to make the same election reports than the American colleagues do or others do. But we can maybe show what happens in parts of the regions of the world, how is the interest in the candidates, and to maybe show also the effects on this electoral campaign. And we do a lot of social media. Our bureau in Washington is very active on social media. They're very innovative, and so we going this way, because I think doing classical TV, you have to do it, but I think this is where social media is really great, because people like to discuss this, and a lot of people we know comment on this. So personally, I'm quite happy with these kind of election. I mean, it's people are interested in, but well, the Americans have to choose, not we.
Cécile, do you agree?
Yeah, I agree. it's a running gag. yes, it's. Anyway, we don't vote, but it's interesting all the planet. So I think what we have to do, as for example on the French channel of RFI and France 24, we are going to work together, TV and radio, and we are going to deal with what does our main listeners think of the situation in America. For example, Africa, we'll have a panel in several cities in Africa on the day after to talk about the result and to not to judge, but to react on the result. And I remember after the first election of Barack Obama, we had a debate between the Nigerian and the Senegalese president on air on RFI the morning after the first election. And I think we have to do this, because it's a way for us to engage also with our listeners, to have their leaders on our programs, and to deal with what happens somewhere else in the world.
Okay, Libby Liu is director of Radio Free Asia. In 60 seconds or so, what do listeners in the region that you're targeting make of the US election, do you think? 1+ billion in China, for example.
Well, I think to the large extent in China, the opinions are carefully crafted and cultivated in the audiences there by the central state media. So it's going to be a lot of who does the CCP think is best for them. That's what I think is going on in China.
And have they got an opinion yet?
It seems to be more and more that they're leaning towards Trump, in my opinion, but thank God they don't vote. I'm sorry. I mean, they
Nobody
don't vote.
Nobody got that on tape, did they? No.
Sorry.
Thank you, Libby. There was a question somewhere over here. Let's see. Can you put your hand up again so I can find who you are? And don't forget to tell us who you are and where you're from, because that always adds to the interest.
Yes, thanks, Emeline. I'm Konstantin Agat. I work for Russia's only remaining independent TV channel, Deutsche TV, and also write a column for Deutsche Welle. As someone who worked for the BBC Russian service for 10 years as bureau chief in Moscow, I'd like to congratulate all the participants on a very substantive debate, which is finally about values and content, rather than how do we use modern gadgetry to reach out to audiences, which is really great. And my question is, in my time working for the BBC, a lot of problems that we encountered was that an offer that we were making, quality as it is, was perceived as, well, essentially propaganda. Essentially, they're trying to sell us something, and that is an across-the-board phenomenon in, say, the post-Soviet space, which I know best. Do you think that the last few years, last 4 or 5 years, of this rapid-fire development in social networks and of essentially major European crisis, do you think that your respective organizations managed to overcome, at least to some extent, this prejudice of kind of foreigners trying to tell us how to live? Thank you very much.
Okay, who would like to take that first? Go on, Peter.
Yes, I think we managed to do a little, one has to say, because first of all, from my experience, international broadcasters are not mass media. I mean, we reach a certain amount of people. These people must be, first of all, interested in something happening abroad or something, or a second opinion, because normally they have their state television or their private television in their country. So, and it's very difficult nowadays to reach the Russian population because they're heavy under their propagandistic umbrella of their own state television or private television, whatever you call it. So it is not an easy task, but I think the numbers we reach and the feedback we get is quite promising, that there is a certain amount of people who are really need these kind of offers, also to ensure themselves that that there still are people outside of this country who might see the world a bit differently. And I'm not a fan of trying to convince everybody saying my opinion is the right one, but I just want to show that there are other opinions. And so I think this approach is maybe a bit better than saying you have to think this and otherwise your president is totally wrong and only we from Europe know how it is. And we also have to show the debates which are in Europe, in Western Europe, about the question how is Russia seen and are there maybe arguments from the Russian side which are valuable to consider. And that there is also a debate about these arguments, and it's not only the one-sided European, Western European, who tries to insult President Putin. So I think we're doing quite a good job on this. We have invested since the Crimean crisis in our Russian program, and I'm optimistic, but I know I'm realistic too. We won't convince now. In a couple of months, every Russian who still believes that the West is an evil thing and full of whatever decadency and whatever prejudice. So hopefully we continue to do a good job.
John Lansing.
Agree, and just a note on the panel you had before lunch, the representative from RT commented that it would be good for Russian citizens to hear media or see or experience media from outside sources, and so we welcome that. We would love to see Radio Free Europe and Voice of America allowed, frankly. I think Russian citizens would benefit from having a plurality of voices just like American citizens do, or German citizens, or British citizens, or French citizens. And that's really the line. You know, there's sometimes there's the charge that it's propaganda fighting propaganda, and it's just not true. It's essentially proven by the fact that there is not a single voice that represents America. You know, there's a, we just talked about the two political parties are entirely two different voices at the very least, if not dozens of different voices. And the mission of the BBG is to include a plurality around the world of opinions and perspectives. But if your goal as a state or as a government and a country is to have one perspective that's controlled and facts are used to shape a narrative that's predetermined for a particular outcome, that is propaganda. To present a plurality of opinions and facts, empirical facts, isn't propaganda. It's just the only antidote to propaganda, which is the truth.
Thank you. We have time for one more question. Yes, yes.
Thank you. Mina Baktash, BBC. I just heard Peter talking about investment after Ukrainian events, and the issue that after certain events in different parts of the world, certain services getting funding, it looks like reactive journalism. And don't you think that reactive journalism makes it sound like propaganda?
No. It depends on who is going to be addressed and who is addressing. So I think when you have a crisis, you have to react. And I think it is not automatically that when you say there is a problem in the world and there is disinformation, that you react on this. So a reaction to an obvious fault or an obvious lie or being untrue is not automatically propaganda. I mean, if propaganda, it would be if the reaction of ours would have been, now we tell also some funny stories or invent stories to influence Russian people. But we didn't. We tried to be as accurate and balanced as possible. And so I wouldn't say that automatically a reaction to a crisis is anti-propaganda, no.
On that note, we are very nearly out of time. What I'd like to do is ask our panelists for their 40 seconds, 45 seconds tops, thoughts about the future and any things that have come out of this debate that particularly have caught their attention. Let's start with Jean-Philippe.
Well, I think it's what the panel proved, that it's crucial to have international broadcasting. When we shifted from local to global, we need somehow to go local again. But don't fall into the tricks of the past that we have top-down messages, but try to engage much more with the audience, because also on the topic of Russia, there's not just one voice coming from Russia. We need to better understand the Russians and the people in the street as well. And I think that's a challenge, but also an opportunity we get as media to connect with the audience and to publish news in a different way.
Okay, thank you, John.
I think a lot about just really understanding our audiences and building our strategies back from the field back. And in addition to understanding our audiences, really understanding our partners, our distribution partners like John Momo, and how we can work together and create unique opportunities for U.S. international media to have a unique impact around the world.
Mm-hmm. Cécile.
I think we have to make more place, even more place to debate, and not on reaction, but it's the core of what we have to do. We have to promote debate on our whatever platform it is, radio, TV, digital. And I think as international media, we also have to always have in mind that we are in the breaking news all the time, but we have to have place also to get a step back and see the context, see the history, see the look at the memory of what we've done. And we have a large part of our programs which are this kind of programs regarding what's happening in the world and making a context of this. And I think it's also one of the richest part we can deal with as an international broadcaster. Responsible international broadcaster.
Mm-hmm. Peter.
I could do it in 3 seconds and say I agree. But I think what I've learned is, and what maybe everybody should take home, is that international broadcasting is getting more and more important, and it will be successful if it's going more digital and being more into corporations.
Peter, thank you. Well, as we've learned over the last 90 minutes or so, we think international broadcasting does have a future, which I'm very pleased about, since I run the industry body for international broadcasting, so I've got a job for at least another 6 months. Whether I'll ever be invited back here again is a different matter. I think it's going to depend on how I vote on the 23rd of June.
Maybe you need to have another base.
Yes.
London is out.
Are you offering a... No, never mind. But thank you all very much for your attention, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you've enjoyed this discussion. Please join me with thanking the panelists, Jean-Philippe de Tender, John Lansing, Cécile Mégie, and Peter Limbourg. Thank you. Thank you. I think you've got to go.
And many thanks to Simon Spanswick. Now it's time for a coffee break. Have you got too many people to meet in too little time? Problem solved. Stop by the interactive corner during the break for a rapid round of networking. Enjoy.